gather this day.
For the harvest is ripe and the workers are few.
And the wheat must be separated from the weeds in the field.
Then let us proclaim the word of the Lord that all might hear.
And let our hearts sing out the praises of Almighty God.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for your promise to be with us always and the joy of knowing that you are present with us right now. Speak your words of life to our being. We pray you would deeply and compassionately let us see your greatness and your love. Thank you that we would have the knowledge of you as our faithful creator. Amen.
Amen.
Let us join in hymn 379.
God of grace, we live in a world that rewards the strong and violates the weak. Forgive us for the ways in which we adopted the values of this world. Teach us to welcome our weakness as opportunities to rest in your spirit. We are so readily seduced by the power of words that when our own words fail us, we feel lost. In deceiving ourselves, we have failed a world that desperately needs to know hope. Teach us to be still enough to find the powerful hope that lies in your love, shown to us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Amen.
Dear Lord, hear now our individual confessions made to you in silence. the good news. For by grace you have been saved. And this is none of your own doing, it is a gift from God. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Quartet with Judy Casey, Wende Clausen, Debbie Grimm, and Anne McAuliffe.
Thank you, ladies. Psalm 86. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name.
I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and will gladly glorify your name forever.
For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol.
God, the insolent are raising against me. A band of ruffians seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O
Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant. Save the children of your servant's maid.
Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame. Because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me.
Good morning.
Good morning.
One of the things I want to tell you is I have these glasses on. I broke my glasses. It broke last night. And these glasses that I have on, I use them for driving a car. And I do a lot of driving, and I need a special pair of glasses that I'm able to see the speedometer and stuff with, and these are them. The other ones I use for preaching. Well, they're sitting home on a desk, but the lens broke out on one of the sides, and I tried like heck to put it in there. I'm a pretty mechanical guy. So I went out and tried to get them fixed last night, $20 at Walmart. And they seemed to work pretty good. So if I stammer or trip over a word, please, be merciful. Let us hear this reading of the Holy Scripture. And this is from the book of Matthew, the 13th chapter. He, meaning Jesus, put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sows good seeds in a field. But while everybody was sleeping, the enemy came and sowed weeds amongst the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the laborers of the household came and said to him, meaning the landlord, Master, did you not sow good seeds in the field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, An enemy has done this. The laborers said to him, Then do you want us to go out and gather them? But he said to them, No, for in gathering the weeds, we would also uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into the barn. Then he, meaning Jesus, left the crowd and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field. He answered, The one who sows the good seeds is the Son of Man. The field of the world and the good seeds are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one. And the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age. And the reapers are the angels. Just as the weeds have been collected, and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of the kingdom all causes of sin and evildoers. they will be thrown into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone who has ears listen. Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you would hide your servant behind the shield of your love for us. Lord, we would ask that you would hide your servant in such a way that nothing would distract him. Lord, we would pray that the words that would utter from his lips would be to your glory and not to man. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus understood the reality in ways that none of us will ever know. He lived in a world as the Son of God and the Son of Man. The incarnation of God in human flesh. Fully God, yet fully human. He was aware of the intentional relationship of all life shining, no brighter than in this parable. In the gospel lesson today on earth, this earthly story, with a heavenly meaning, Jesus peels away the simple truth that he offers today. You know, the parable brings us the good news, the broadcasting, the seeds of the field. And as the years pass, the farmer sets aside the best grain, and he puts that best grain in a place in the barn that he can take and continue his enterprise as a farmer. He's dependent on that strong grain for the years to come. But this year, something terrible happened. The enemy sowed amongst his seed of wheat in a dastardly act, things that would affect the ground. As he overlooked his field one morning, he noticed the ugly, choking weeds that were growing amongst the prized wheat that gave him his livelihood. His workers feared for their jobs as the farmer. "You sow good seed," he asked. They asked. Can you just imagine what they were really saying? I guess they were asking for mercy, lest they believe their master thought that they did. Thinking on their feet, immediately the workers offered to pull out the weeds. The master, however, shunned the workers by telling them to leave the fields alone. In gathering up the wheat, you would uproot the wheat. Gathering up the weeds, you would uproot the wheat. Let me try it again. In gathering up the wheat, you would uproot the wheat. In gathering up the weeds, you would uproot the wheat. My glasses, I'm sorry. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And then he tells them to harvest the weeds and take them and bundle them up and burn them and put the others in the barn. Actually, with this parable of sowing, our Lord offers an interpretation in verse 36 and 43. Teaches his disciples then now that weeds are in fact of a kingdom life. In other words, what he's telling them is weeds are sowed and are obstacles within our lives. The hurting, the things that interfere with our spirituality in some cases, that cause us to turn not away from God, but to neglect some of the things that we're called to do. They are excuses. They are people that would rather have us, that would rather have us put away our harvest for another time. What does this parable mean today? Perhaps the key of hearing this parable has to do with weed control. Think of just one of the ugly, hurtful, death-dealing realities of the world today. We have war, we have famine, we have people who are hungry, we have property that's being destroyed. Disregard for the sacred nature of life itself. Get the picture? At times, our world seems to be choking in the weeds that have gathered in God's field. What do we do? Are we ready to do weed control? Take almost any destructive issue among us. You will find rather people urging us to organize, to march, petition, and marshal all of the forces of God's church to root out the weeds. Jesus offers another opportunity. It is not popular to some amongst us, but we'll say that our world is so corrupt. Christ's people must fight the roots of the weeds to root them out. Yet that is not what the Lord advises us to do. In fact, Jesus not only suggests, but commands that we leave the weeds alone. This one singular instruction flies in the face of what we could call common decency. No, Jesus does not suggest that either. On the contrary, Jesus actually admonishes us to be focused on sowing, nurturing, encouragement, and growing gospel wheat that the weeds will not survive. Rather than pulling up the weeds, Jesus calls us to grow strong, healthy, and bountiful wheat. This is exactly the same message out of the Lord given to Peter. Jesus said to Peter, "The keys of the kingdom, I say to him, you are Peter. On this rock I will build the church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it." What does that mean? Meaning that hell's fury will not stop God's church when God's people are committed to grace, living in love, and being God's presence in the world. Weed control has nothing to do with pulling up the weeds. Rather, weed control has everything to do with being strong, healthy, nourishing wheat, and that's us. You ask, how does this work? Simply, Jesus said, anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also a second one. That's in Matthew 5. Shun people with how graciously you serve others. And again, if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek. More gospel messages are spread in turning the other cheek, and bringing more people to know who Christ is simply by being loving and caring, not being fearful. It's easy enough to clench your fist than it is to turn the other cheek. It's easy enough to smile when you really want to say something else. It's easy enough to look somebody right in the eye rather than looking the other way. You know, I made a very interesting decision years ago. If you see me talking to you, you see me looking in your eyes, usually your left one. That comes from being honest with yourself. I'm not trying to convince you of anything. I'm trying to be sincere with you being important to me. I'm not trying to sell you anything except Christ. That's what I do. But I don't do it just by looking in your eye. I set it by example. And that's what we're all supposed to do. More gospel messages are spread on the turning of the cheek than a clenched fist. This is the power of the gospel unleashed in the world. Unleashed in the world. That knows neither how to do anything except nourish God's love in Christ and readily to transform the things that God would have us do. Weed control has nothing to do with pulling out the weeds. Weed control has everything to do with being God's people of grace and truth and acceptance and forgiveness, generous and hospitable to the world. The way of life in Christ utterly is the way of love. But remember, the true sower of salvation and the seed is the Lord Jesus Christ. He alone can give the power for one's heart to be transformed in a living way. He is the one who saves sinners through the preaching and the witnessing of believers. And that's from Romans 10. This week, refuse to give up being caught in any cause other than the movement of Jesus launched over 2,000 years ago. His movement is like the field which the farmer sowed with good wheat, believing that God would one day gather the bounty of the harvest from the choices we make to live and share the good news in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Oh.
Please let us pray before we recite the Apostles' Creed. Jesus said, it is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Lord, you infuse us with the inner strength we need. By the power we are able to endure all things. We trust your word and be individuals that are striving to live by your commandments. We learn peace and commitment in every circumstance. Amen.
Amen.
Let us join in the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Well, I thank you again for allowing me to fill the pulpit this week, and I look forward with the opportunity for next week as well. Thank you. And ladies, you did a great job singing today. Very, very good. Reminded me that I have got to pray more, and thank you for that. You know, the time that I've spent here has been very fulfilling. Did you notice that I misread a couple of the words of the Apostles' Creed? That's because I come from a slightly different background, so don't take it personally. My glasses don't help. But it's okay. One of the things that I want to talk about is, let me see if I can find it here. We're going to pray a little bit, but one of the things I wanted to talk about was how many people we had look at us last week. Not that we're bragging, that's not why I'm telling you. But I think there's about 140 or something like that. I don't have it here. I used to be organized and then I woke up. Anyway, we had over 100 people that viewed last week's service, which I thought was absolutely remarkable. And I was very excited to hear that today. But again, we don't do that for bragging. We do that because of you, the folks that belong to this congregation and how we share the gospel and all of the things that we do and set. And we thank you for that. Let us join the prayer of the people, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Almighty and loving God, creator of life and giver of grace, we thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for the joy of our salvation and the renewing of life given power of our faith. Remind us that we are made new by the presence and power of your Holy Spirit. We pray today for all of those who have lost hope to the poison of skepticism. Events in their lives may have shrunk their highest values and most cherished dreams. Illness disappoints and betrays, and even death rob them of their joy. Come to them, we ask you. And we ask you, Lord, as we go on with this prayer, for your loving hearing, for your loving healing of those that we've spoken about, for those that have heartbreak in their bodies and their minds are difficult
and spinning. We pray for the healing of the sick, comfort of the grieving, food and shelter for those that need a blessing. We ask all of these things today and allow your Holy Spirit to come amongst us and connect us even closer to you and one another. We especially hold up those that are on our prayer list. And Lord, we think of them now, Lorraine and Ricky, Anna, John, Kelly, Michael, Pop-Pop, Laura's dad and brother who's in the hospital, Jack, Jesse, George, Nancy, Amy, David, Josh, Karen P., on the loss of her husband, John, Kathy, and the loss of her mother. Karen, as she continues to go through chemo, and Don and Roy, Vanessa and Jack, and also my wife, Judy, goes for surgery again 4 weeks from now and continues to need that surgery so she can get up and walk. God of nourishment and grace, mold us in your loving grace that we may be the people known for the ways we love one another and you, showing by our actions and our words, that you are the risen and living Redeemer. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray, as we continue and join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now it's time for the offering, and one of the things that I want to point out is there's four different ways that we can do that. We can mail in an offering, we can text it, we can pay a bill, if your bank offers that. We can also do e-giving. And those ways are certainly the necessity. Right now, with the church being closed, the finances don't stop, and there are things that have to be done in order to keep the church functioning. And we would ask you to continue to do that. And remember that that giving is something that God tells us is very, very important. Let us now take the offer.
Thank you.
gift to you is known, how we choose to live our lives, including our choice to offer to advance the work of this church. So take these gifts from our hands, loving God, along with our prayers, that they may help accomplish not our will, but the will that you have and your intent. Multiply the seeds sown this day, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.